there was a day I still remember, you know, when I had like 3-4 guys sitting in front of me, my 3-4 associates, and I'm like, guys, I don't have money, you know, to run the business. And I think tomorrow, I don't even know we're going to open the office or not.
What's good, you guys? Welcome to the first episode of The Entrepreneur Talks. In the world where people often give up on their dreams for stability and security, today we have someone with us who has successfully escaped this rat race and follow his dream to become an entrepreneur. He is super energetic, very hardworking, a good leader, but above all of this, he is a great learner. We have the owner of the Triforce Incorporation, Mr. Mayank Singh. I hope you enjoyed this episode. See you on the other side. Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
So I'm going to start this interview with, can you just give us the brief introduction of the Triforce Incorporation?
All right, so Triforce is basically a need-based startup. You know, when I say need-based, means with the emerging trends of social media, right? People have actually forgotten the human touch. The human interaction is absolutely gone.
Yes.
So what is Triforce is nothing but what we've done is we've taken over this whole human commercials and made it a business. This is not something which is very, very new. This is, I think, the oldest form of advertising. Triforce is a direct sales and direct marketing company. We're basically into face-to-face human commercials. And we cater to a lot of different clients from non-government sector, non-profitable organizations. We are with insurance clients. We are with entertainment. We are with applications like Google. That's one of our premier clients as well. So, and all these big companies, you know, they really want us to go out and talk to people on behalf of them.
So while we were interacting before this interview, you said to me that you had a very secure job and like, and you were also earning around right 50K, right?
Yeah.
That was also back in 2008-9.
2011, yes. I passed out my engineering in 2010.
That was like a good money. Back in 2011-12, that was 50,000 is like kind of a good money.
Yes.
So, so what motivated you to leave this kind of a secure job and start something new, this kind of a business?
When I started working my company, right? I don't want to mention the name over here, but then I think it was a good company. They gave me my first break and having a good package as well. But then what really was missing was, you know, I didn't see myself growing. And when you talk about job security, I think jobs are the most insecure places in the world. Why? Because a couple of days back, Jet Airways closed down. Because of that, 22,000 people lost their jobs. You tell me, where's the security? Right? And that is something, you know, I think it's a matter of a choice that you want to make. But I always felt that, you know, I was kind of insecure because I've always been a freebie in my life. And I really wanted to be more free. You know, freedom was something that I was looking out for, which I was not really getting in my previous company, right? The freedom to express myself and grow at the pace where I really want to grow. And the second reason of leaving a job was because I saw my family struggling, you know, with finances. And it was hard because I still remember as a kid and I wanted a cricket kit, right? And my dad was not able to buy that kit. I was really good in sports. Back then, I did not realize it, but I used to always cry that why am I not given the luxuries that all my friends can have, right? I calculated this long back that if I want to go out and drive the cars that I really want, I want to live in the houses that I really want to, and I clearly understood that I cannot really have the luxury that I want to have if I continue doing that job. I think that was one reason because I was very clear with my approach. I'll give you a great example. For example, let's say there's a lion, right? And that lion is inside a jungle. Now, he's absolutely free, but there's too much of insecurity, right? He doesn't get his shelter. He might sleep hungry. The same lion, you cage him into a zoo, right? Inside a zoo, yes. And inside a zoo, he's 100% secured. Nobody's going to come and kill him. And he is getting his 3-4 times meal. But you only tell me, where will the lion be more happy? In the jungle itself. Why? Because he's free. So I was kind of that jungly lion, right? But in 2010-11, I was caged. And I wanted to break the cage and I was somehow successful. A lot of times people accept the cage, right? It's just that I wasn't able to. I'm not saying others are wrong. Neither am I saying I'm right. It's just that that's not something what was me. And that's the reason I decided to come out.
So, sir, what were the 3 most important principles you had considered while starting your new business?
The first principle for me, because I understood my previous company, was the concept of shareholder supremacy. Now, shareholder supremacy concept means the owner of the company takes the maximum profits and the people working under him get a fixed salary, right? And when I was placed in my previous company, I realized that I am at the grassroots level. And for me to be at the top or reach to the top is not possible. End of the day, what I wanted to create a model, you know, which was an anti-supremacy concept, where I wanted to give everybody in my company an equal opportunity, that if there are 100 people at the grassroots level, everybody in my company gets an equal opportunity to reach to the top of the organization. The second concept is that even you guys should know, is concept of generations. Now, it's not a concept, it's basically a book. Generation says that in every 100 years, the world goes through the same cycle in terms of technology, in terms of everything. I'll give you a great example. So when you look at your cell phones, right? Before the signature, you know, people learned how to do a signature for themselves. What was the mode of identity? That was thumbprint. Now you look at your cell phones, it's the same thumbprint. Artificial intelligence has been added, but end of the day, the identity is the thumbprint. With this concept of generation, that things do come back, right? What we use is direct sales or face-to-face advertising. It's not something which is new. It's actually the first and the oldest mode of advertising. It's not new. Yes, we have packaged it. And the third concept is the law of diffusion innovation. That means the person who innovates something in XYZ, any century, he's done something that nobody has ever done before, right? The competition over there is less. There's less competition on internet. There was rather less competition on internet in 2000, early 2000, 2001, 2005. Now there's too much of crowd on internet. Digital is populated, right? And that's the same thing. So if you want to go out and make a lot of money for yourself, you have to drift yourself into the 3% category. You've got to go into a domain or an industry where actually nobody wants to step into.
So what was your biggest failure and what kind of mistakes you do while running your business?
When I look at my whole journey of 7 years now, I've been running it's 2012 to 2019, it's been 7 years now. And over a period of time, you know, like 3 years, 4 years, I think it was the fifth year, 2017 it was. And my business saw a sudden breakdown. Now, I don't know why it was, right? I started blaming almost every possible thing, right? I started blaming the demonetization as well. Because of that, my business is not growing. Because when you're not doing well, you really want to blame somebody. There was a day, I still remember, you know, when I had like 3-4 guys sitting in front of me, my 3-4 associates, and I'm like, guys, I don't have money, you know, to run the business. And I think tomorrow, I don't even know we're going to open the office or not. I'll tell you the reason why. I'll tell you the reason. Because when you start making, you know, money, I was just 25 back then, understand. I started buying luxury cars. You know, I bought my first, I bought my third car there. Right. I started investing or spending, I won't say investment, money on depreciating assets. Right. I used to party almost every weekends. I used to take almost 30-40 people out every month, you know, to different places, blew away all the money. And sometimes when I didn't have money, I used to swipe my credit cards for, you know, the money that's going to come up. That's the future money. Within a month from the top of my peak of my career, I was at the rock bottom. Still remember, there was one Diwali, and I was all alone at my home, right? There was nobody. I usually go home, you know, my home is in Kanpur, I go home. But that year I didn't even go home, right? Because I did not have money to travel, because I was like, if I spend 10,000 rupees flying down to my city, right? And then coming back, rather 10,000, I can probably just take care of my monthly expenses. Now imagine a person who's spending 4-5 lakhs, suddenly gets his lifestyle down to 10,000. It's a big blow, right? But I think that has been the best part of my life. right? Because from there itself, I understood, you know, certain lessons that I don't think I would have learned, you know, in the books. And I don't think I would have learned if that wouldn't have happened.
So, sir, my last question to you is, what advice you want to give to a budding entrepreneur?
The only advice that I want to give to everybody is, be humble. Why? Because you're nobody in the world. Nobody is going to look at your success, look at your failure, right? And nobody, you know, develops any perception about it. So when you're taking advices, people are going to talk about their opinions. One, don't take advices. If you feel anything which is going to work for you, just do it. Don't get into a business for trial, right? When you're doing a business, do it with the perspective of 40 years, 50 years, 60 years. As an entrepreneur, first thing is learn everything of your business. Everything. From the sales, to the recruiting, to the finances, to the administration, to the operations, production, whatever the business you're into. But you've got to know everything, right? So these are certain advices. And the last is, I think, the most important one. Be patient, because it is not going to happen suddenly. You know, I heard this great line long back that you are the average of five people that you spend your maximum time with. So if you want to be a billionaire, first of all, figure out five billionaires. Spend your 3 years with them. And the fourth year, you're going to be a billionaire yourself. Don't live, you know, the life on terms and conditions that are set by society. Remember, it's one life. Don't think twice.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much.